Medicating myself,
right.
And so I jumped in, and so I roared into my addiction, you know, and so it was hard to stop me. And then with the mental illness stuff, you know, going on, like I said, I thought the place where they sent me at, the supportive housing, I thought it would be the place where, you know, this is for you, that they would have people there to help me, which they didn't. And these supportive housing is over human services, which CPS do not have a clue about what's happening with human service, which Trip Royal is over. So, I mean, I got to run around. So then I also, you know, felt that, you know, it wasn't my first time in CPS. You know, I have daughters 35, but all my children were like 10, 11 years apart, except my last two babies. So I had kind of like a history because I didn't want to work with my mental illness. And so, you know, I started working, I believe I had been clean for 14 years. And I've been working here, and I worked in the Western Addition when a lot of violence was going on in the Western Addition, shootings and killings. I put my life on the line. You know, I was pregnant with my kids. I went out there. I started talking to the kids. You know, I tried to help make change, but a lot of people that, you know, kind of like you thinking that they working with you, and then once you start finding out that they're not really for the community, and I see that now in the Western Addition. A lot of people that was at the table, you know, saying that they were going to help our community, they're not there no more. And, you know, and it's just like our community is like, it's not, you know, it's not there anymore. It's just like, it's kind of, you know, really hard, and I struggle too, because during the time when they told the Fillmore down the first time, it was through redevelopment, and I was a little girl, and I remember that white man coming to my grandmother's house and asking how many kids, but when I got older, I didn't know that I could get a place. I didn't find out that I can get a place, not maybe 6 years ago. I found out about six, 8 years ago, I found out about a certificate that I could have had a place. And it was times during that time that I stayed with my kid's daddy's mother, you know. I didn't know. Nobody informed me, you know. And I still have, you know, stuff around that. And I still have things around, you know, how could they get this money from the federal government, and they're supposed to use it at that particular time, but they held that money from 68 up to now, and now they're building places, but it's not for those people that was raised, or their children who was raised in there. It's like other people are taking those places, and we can't afford those $2,500 a month for rent. So, you know, I'm very, you know, it's just like a lot of African Americans are being displaced in this community, I mean, in San Francisco, and it's hard. You know, you don't want to go to a shelter, and I just realized, you know, everybody just thinks that thing about the water going up there, and they're and everybody's in Chico and stuff, and even those people got homes and everything. Those people don't even want to stay in the shelter. They want to stay in the hotel, or they'd rather stay in their car, and that's how people, you know, feel when they homeless here in the city. People don't want people to know. You wouldn't even know I was homeless until I told you. You know, I sleep on my godmother's couch today, you know, until my name happened to come up, you know. So it's very hard because it's really attacking the African Americans, really, because they're, you know, the kids are being taken away if you don't have a place, or if you don't have a grandmother, or you don't have somebody to take care of your children. You know, your kids are stuck in the system. If they're until they maybe 13, 14, 15, and you know they can say, oh, I don't want to stay there. I want to go be able to. Then our kids are being lost to the streets. What do we do then? Then they say, oh, look at those kids doing that. But that's not to me, it doesn't fall on me. I mean, you know, part of it do, but it's still part. Falls on the city and county of San Francisco, the CPS system, the housing system, and how they operate, you know, with this. And this has been going on for years and years, and they still haven't came up with a plan. So what do we do? I mean, so what's supposed to happen? Do our children supposed to be lost to the streets? You know, you don't have a place to stay, but you're trying to get a place to stay, and you know, it's just hard. So I just encourage everybody to, you know, to hang in there and try to, you know, to fight for our rights. We do need our rights. And he was talking about the Black History thing, and I brought this up. I'm gonna try to find people to help, but Juneteenth, you know, I didn't really know a lot about Juneteenth, and I started being on a committee, and then I started learning more and more, you know. My mother told me years ago that, you know, but I didn't, you know, I was like, oh, the slaves are free, you know, because my mother's birthday is on the 18th of June. And then, so, you know, and then I was like, oh, because she used to say, yeah, the slaves are free between them, you know. Then so, then I finally started finding I was on the duty committee. And so I feel for myself that I think Black History Month should be in June, because that's the day that the slaves are free, and Juneteenth, and it all climbs together. So I was so, I'm trying to see if I can get some type of, you know, find some outreach or something. If anybody know, I have any suggestions for we can try to push this agenda ahead, because it is, you know, Black History is in February, and we have Chinese New Year's in February. We have President's birthdays in February, and it's like, you know, we need our own month, and you know, Juneteenth is our month when we were free, and I feel that June should be the day that Black History, the whole month of Black History, should be established with everybody.
Speaker, she's a dedicated survivor, proud African American queen. She was born and raised in San Francisco. You don't want me to tell you that when you were born. It makes me feel real old up here. She is a peer organizer here at the Coalition on Homelessness. And a nighttime desk clerk who does in-home care for elderly and disabled adults and disabled children. She loves the cause, and she loves to be part of the change that is so desperately needed right now. And she's a proud, phenomenal mother of three beautiful children, and she is dedicated, committed herself here. We love her here at the Coalition and the work she puts in. She is a person that she belongs in the first column of people, and people, there's three columns of people, right? Or three positions people are in this country, and one is those people who make things happen. That position, that column, that are those people who watch things happen. And it's those, that color of people wonder what the F happened.
Yeah.
So she is in that first column. And if some of y'all being in one of the columns, you need to move yourself to that first column too, right? You might want to ask yourself, what column are you in? Because we need change. Is that right?
Yeah.
We need, this can't go any further, right? This is jacked up, right? We need change. And that change is not going to come from Bernie Sanders or Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump or whoever's sitting up there in that White House, right? It's not going to come from our supervisor, right? People make change. People make history, right? And you got it, right? So when you leave out here today, you all going to be in that first column, right?
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
All right. Okay. So, without further ado, running my mouth on the braid, Sister Jackie.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, I too have, you know, been through a lot, you know, throughout my life. And I feel that everything that I've been through, it was for a reason, because it makes me who I am today, and I'm proud of that. Sometimes people say that the stuff that you've been through, oh, you feel bad about it, you know, but I can tell my daughter, had I had not went through some of the things that I went through, then she would not be born, her brothers wouldn't be born. So I had to go through what I went through to get to where I am, to have the children that I have, and to have this job. Had I not made some of those decisions, I wouldn't be here. And there's a woman that I really adore. Her name is Maya Angelou, and I love everything that she's done, you know, in her life. and I love her. So I got two poems that I would like to read from Maya Angelou. One is Still I Rise. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still, like the dust, I rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you basic with gloom? Because I walk like I've got oil wells pumping in my living room. Just like moons and like suns, with the certainty of tides, just like hopes springing high, still I rise. Did you want to see me broken, bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops weakened by my soulful cries? Does my haughtiness offend you? Don't you take it awful hard? Because I laugh like I've got gold mines digging my own backyard. You may shoot me with your words. You may cut me with your eyes. You may kill me with your hatefulness, but still, like air, I rise. Does my sexiness upset you? Does it come as such a surprise that I dance like I've got diamonds at the meeting of my thighs? Out of the huts of history's shame, I rise. Up from the past that rooted in my pain, I rise. I'm a black ocean leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into daybreak like worldliness, wonderfulness clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hopes of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise.
All right.
Phenomenal speaker is a hardworking mom who, even after getting her housing, has continued to support the community and organization of this organization in hopes that all families and individuals will have a home. And she is also the cook of the soul food. Okay. So we like to bring her up. We love her here at the Coalition. She's one of our committed, dedicated people here that keep this organization going and is out there every day making sure that people are being treated in a most righteous way, in
That's
a most
right.
equal way. And so I want to bring up Andrea.
Andrea!
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hello, everybody.
Hi.
Happy Valentine's.
Happy Valentine's.
And I'm asking everyone, can you be my Valentine's today? Yeah. And I'm yours. So, how's everybody doing today?
All right.
We got some beautiful weather outside, and it's always a pleasure to be here in the mix of all of you guys. You know, I've been in this city for 40 years now, and I have been a caregiver for 40 years, working with disabled, with seniors, and up until about 4 years ago. When I came here about 4 years ago, when I came to Coalition, my sister here, Tina, and my other sister brought me here. I was homeless. I was staying in a hotel with some of the most rudest caregivers of that hotel management that was possibly be. I went through a whole lot, but I was able to bring up my daughter at the hotel, which at the time when we moved in that hotel, she was only 6 years old. So we stayed in that hotel for over 4 years, 4.5 years we was there. And I came to work here, and I was able to work in that hotel and also bring my daughter up in that hotel and kept her away from all the bad things that was up in that hotel, because I was able to change things in there. I helped a whole lot of young ladies and young men that was up in there doing on drugs and everything. I used to be on drugs and everything and stuff, so that's why I was able to help others. And now today I still get calls and emails and texts from some of the young men and ladies that I helped to straighten out their lives. And And through hard work and dedication, we can always turn our lives around and do better for ourselves. That's what I've always been taught. And by being here and helping, even now when I'm walking down the street and I'm seeing the police harassing the homeless out there, I pull my car over and I stop.
Right.
And I have something to say. Leave them alone. Because if it wasn't for what's going on around here, and I want you guys to do that too. If they're harassing our people out there on the streets, have something to say. Because you know what? It's a reason why we're out there homeless. Because of the high tycoon that wanted to, that moved in here and took over everything and not giving housing away. We have housing. We shouldn't be having all the people out there that's homeless that we do have out there. It's totally ridiculous. Not especially in San Francisco, because we got too much of a money flow going around from here to not be able to house people, not to be able to open up centers, not to be able to open up shelters where we can be at. And it's bad where the homeless have a war waged on them where they don't have any place to go and a place to live. When you go down the street and you're looking at all these high rises that are going up here in this city, and all the housing that is going up in this here city, that can't nobody get in there to afford it. You don't have no money.
That's right.
And then you're out there on the streets and you end up getting these frivolous tickets. You end up getting, you know, harassed by the police and everything. And then when it comes down to you, and on top of that, you got evictions on you.
Yeah.
You got bad credit because of the evictions that was not your fault half the time. And then when it comes down to you finally trying to get into a place to live, they go all through your background and check out everything. And then, oh, no, you can't come live here because you know what? You got an eviction or you got bad credit or, a something else that's bad. That is probably not even your fault that these things have happened to you. But with us together and us, if we're going to keep on fighting and we're going to keep on striving and we're not going to stop until we get what we want. And we're going to get it. I want to read this here scripture. It's on my phone, and I want to read this scripture to everyone this morning. I'm reading from Psalm 27, verse 21 to 24. And this is going to be us real soon. Okay. The wicked borrows in prayer, not again, but the righteous cure mercy in gift. For such as be blessed of him shall inherit the earth, and they that be cursed of him shall be cut off. The steps of good men are ordered by the Lord, and is in delight in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord uphold him with his hand. And then we're going to go down. And this is the Lord will lead him with his hand, the Lord condemn him when he is judged. Wait on the Lord and keep his way, and he shall exalted inherit the land when the wicked are cut off. God shall see it. And this is what's going to happen for us. We are about to inherit this land back. The poor is finally going to get this land back. The rich is going to be cut down to the knees. You know why? The Lord has said so. He told us, he made us that promise. that he would always take care of us. He made thousands of promises to us that he has kept. And you know what? This is one promise that he has kept for us that we are going to inherit the same debt. And we're going to be sitting on top real soon. All we got to do is keep on believing and keep on walking and keep on fighting. Thank you.
Halle Berry. Is that singing or is that acting?
Grammy. Music.
When do you stand?
Halle Berry.
All right. Okay. Everybody.
But they're only serving
get your book together. Get your black kids my book. Get your book together.
It's a very short one, very long history. I wasn't born in this country. I was born in Honduras, Central America. And I'm also a Garifuna. So Garifuna is a mix of African and Arawak from South America. My ancestors, they were shipped from Nigeria to St. Vincent. So when we got to St. Vincent, we got to mingle with Arawak. Our language is a mix of five different languages. It's starting in African, Arawak, English, French, and Spanish. We were shipped to Honduras in 1796. When we got to Honduras, that's when we spread to all the to Belize, Guatemala, Nicaragua, and some of our Honduras. Our first language, I think it's a unique language. It's the only language in the whole world that has probably language in one. Our product food, a lot of vegetables, a lot of seafood. It's we live by the ocean in Honduras, not just Honduras, but Guatemala and Belize as well. In Nicaragua, in Nicaragua, you can find the rifles in blue fields. In Guatemala, Puerto Varios, and Livingston. In Belize, it's also a mix of the rifles in Miami. We were spread in New York City, in LA, in New Orleans, Houston, and some here in California. And I'm a proud Garifuna because if it wasn't for my language, I wouldn't be able to be who I am today. Every time I walk down the street, I mean, I feel like, you know, I'm a proud Garifuna. And I wish we could just walk out today learning something about each other, because regardless of today, we're still learning love, especially like every day. Today is just the bait, you know, for love and spreading the that kind of energy. And also too, I struggle too as a black man in America, because I'm the physical disabled. You know, when they see me, they see black, but they didn't see my history. So I have to stop people that I can learn from. I didn't know the Black History Month until I got older. Because in high school I was bullied because of the color of my skin. But even though they didn't put the language, but I always felt like, you know, I was being part of Africa, regardless where I'm coming from. You know. So I'm just hoping today that it's a chance for us to walk out and learn something for each other. You know, that we can take that out there and just walk proud of who you are. And that's my little history for you, and I hope you can enjoy that. thank you all. Luego, Jacumbo y Janina, for allowing me to be here today.
Don't stop.
Say what? All right.
to do it, kids. No advance warning. Just go on in.
Yeah.
I don't know, but that's a good idea. It's a great idea. We all are doing the mayor. Oh, no, he's on the golf course, actually.
It's about our African Americans in the Twin Cities. This is one. And I would read a little bit of this thing to you so that you should be able to get the understanding. By the way, my name is Andrea. Hi. And we're also the Homeless Commission on homelessness. And African Americans have woven the providing economic prosperity and culture.
I've been waiting here for 5-10 minutes. And so
yeah, that's okay. But you need to hear this stuff.
That's
not by you. That's Avalon, D.C. 11, Excelsior. Okay. The majority of our African American population has been placed out of this neighborhood they grew up in. African Americans have been evicted at the highest number. African Americans have lost public housing units. When the federal government devastated from housing that housed African Americans. When African Americans lose their home, they often lose their children. You have a lot of that going on.
What's your name?
Alternatively, when African Americans lose their children, they often lose their home. African Americans have been disproportionately locked out of jobs and locked up in jail. A very big population of our people, our men, and our children have been taken out of our homes. We're asking our males, you know, to give back our children, for one, but number one, we need to get our housing back that we have lost. Okay, and today we're giving our love. So we want that love returned by helping us to be repaid. And we also restore the funding for the 105 subsidized units that was given to them. Now it's been taken back away from us. Okay? So we would like that to be restored. And we would like our mayor to join with us and start providing these things for us because we need our children home with us and we need more housing. Okay, so can you let him know that the next time we come to see him, that he come out and have a meeting with us? Woo! Okay?
Get your phone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Just
oh, yeah. people that are sorry, you know, very much. Okay. I tell you what you say, what you mean.
Supervisor and Mayor's Office. My name is Jeffrey Allman, and we have something to say today. African Americans have woven the fabric of San Francisco, providing economic prosperity and creating culture. And now they are being pushed out of the same neighborhoods we built. The majority of our African American population has been displaced out of the neighborhood they grew up in. African Americans have been evicted at the highest numbers. African Americans have lost public housing units when the federal government divested from housing that housed African Americans. When African Americans lose their homes, they lose their children. Alternatively, when African Americans lose their children, they often lose their homes. African Americans have been disproportionately locked out of jobs and locked up in jail. African Americans have been disproportionately shot and killed by the police. And many of these factors have collided to create the crisis we face today of homelessness in the African American community. Only 3% of the San Francisco is African American, yet they make up 40 to 50% of the homeless population. This is the result of racial discrimination. And as African Americans deserve to. Is that what it is?
Equity.
That one right there.
Deserve?
Yes, I deserve.
Mm-hmm.
Equality alongside all African Americans. It is up to elected officials to cure this historic injustice. Today, on Valentine's Day, we are giving you love. And in return, we demand you show some love in honor of African American History Month by restoring funding for the 150 new subsidies that are cut from the budget. Ensure that African Americans hit by homelessness have a seat at the table when issues that affect them are being decided. Ensure that proposed new policies for family shelter honor Black mothers self-determined to do lock them out of services they need. Ensure homeless population equality by creating both a full-service shelter in the Bayview and replacement family emergency shelter with showers, beds, and 24-hour operations. Ensure equality funding for Black-run homeless organizations. Create policies to protect and halt displacement of the African American community and increase the number of African Americans in San Francisco. Take steps locally to halt mass incarceration. Increase housing subsidies for people coming out of foster care. Increase numbers for African American youth. Here is your Valentine's box with messages inside from our children. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. And we will certainly convey the message.
Today. African Americans have woven the fabric of San Francisco, providing economic prosperity and creating culture. and now they're being pushed out of the same neighborhoods they built. The majority of our African-American population has been displaced out of the neighborhoods they grew up in. It includes me. I grew up in the Fillmore, now Lower Pacific Heights. African-Americans have been evicted at the highest numbers. African-Americans have lost public housing units when the federal government divested from housing that housed African-Americans. When African-Americans lose home, they often lose their children. Alternatively, when African-Americans lose their children, they often lose their homes. African-Americans have been disproportionately locked out of jobs, locked up in jail. Many African-Americans have been disproportionately shot and killed by police. Many of these factors have collided to create the crisis we face today of homelessness in the African-American community. Only 3% of San Francisco is African-American, yet they make up 40 to 50% of the homeless population. This is the result of racial discrimination, and as African-Americans deserve equality, equity alongside all San Franciscans, it is up to elected officials to cure this historic injustice. Today on Valentine's Day, we're giving you love, and in return, we demand you show some love and honor African-American History Month
so nice.
By restoring funding for the 155 new subsidies that are cut from the budget. Ensure that African-Americans hit by homelessness have a seat at the table when issues that affect them are being decided. Ensure that proposed new policies for family shelter entry honor black mothers and honor black mothers' self-determination and do not lock them out of services they need. Ensure homeless populations' equity by creating both a full-service shelter in the Bayview and a replacement family emergency shelter with showers, beds, and 24-hour operation. Ensure equitable funding for black-run homeless organizations, craft policies to protect and halt displacement of the African-American community, and increase the number of African-Americans in San Francisco. Take steps locally to halt mass incarceration, increase housing subsidies for people coming out of foster care, increase jobs for African-American youth. Here is a Valentine's Day box with messages inside from our children. Thank you.
Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks for taking the time to come out on Valentine's Day. I really appreciate it. I see some familiar faces, those of you that I don't know. Actually was a commissioner at the Housing Authority, staff at the Housing Authority, started my career there. I worked with the Coalition on Homelessness to help undocumented people stay in public housing. I went on to work with the Mayor's Office of Community Development and Public Works, and then around the corner from the Coalition on Homelessness, the Janitors Union, SCIU of Lane 7, for 8 years. So hear and understand everything you're saying and see it as a big priority. Thank you guys very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm trying to to just get everyone in and close the door. I'm not trying to. Yeah.
Thank you. Valentine's Day box with some messages from our children.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
you for everything you guys do. The supervisor is very supportive of all the efforts that you guys have taken part of, especially with housing a lot of the families that we're losing at a rapid rate. You know, we're deeply concerned about the waiting list issues for family shelters. We're deeply concerned about the cut to subsidies due to the budget issue. And, you know, from our office's perspective, we want to be there working with the community to ensure that the most vulnerable in our communities are going to have a home and a safety net to fall back on in these trying times. You have our commitment to work with you. Please bring us, you know, ideas and amendments or any type of facts or figures to help us make the right decisions. As you know, the budget's not going to be an easy process this year. The supervisor's on the budget committee, and we really do welcome you to challenge us and to bring that information to us and stories to us. Thank you for all the work that you do every day, and you know you have us as a partner to solve some of these problems.
Yay!
All right. Is
okay.
Hey, y'all done?
You don't want something done?
You said
you're going to.
You don't have to. I just feel like that's kind of disrespectful. You always want to be with us out here.
Catering both a full service shelter in the Bayview and a replacement placed in family emergency shelter with showers, beds, and 24-hour operation.
Okay.
Because today now, you know, you have children, if you're in the shelter, you got to leave at a certain time in the morning, and you can't return to a certain time, and you know, you're not allowed to take showers there because there's no showers.
Yeah.
So what are you supposed to take a shower and where are you supposed to let go at if you can't go to the restroom?
Yeah.
At McDonald's or somewhere you know, down the line. It's, I got those things on the corner, but they're not on the call.
Yeah, I
hear you. You know, so, okay. Okay,
and also about our foster children that is coming out of foster care.
Our
children that are coming out of foster care are coming out without housing, are coming out without any funding.
Yeah.
And they're scattered all over the street.
Yeah.
After our children have been taken from us, and they put us through so many changes, with to half the time we don't even get our children back.
Yeah.
And they end up growing up in the foster care. Most of them are being killed in foster care, being killed by the police, or being locked up in jail. And that's because of not having a place to live.
Yeah.
And so as soon as they turn 18, they're kicking them out on the street without housing, without jobs, without schooling or anything.
Sure.
So we got a whole lot of our African American black children are on the streets out there because they have freshly just came out of foster care.
Yeah, right.
So we got a lot of our young people out there on the streets with no place to go because we have no housing.
Right.
And San Francisco got a lot of money, and I don't understand. You just charged me $500 to get my doggone car out of tow, so that $500 should be able to go to housing.
Yeah.
You know, and really need you guys to step into the plate for us and get us some housing so that we can at least try to give our children back into our community.
Perfect.
Can I say something?
Yeah, of course.
I went to a walk of Carol's district yesterday.
Yes.
Hispanic places. So I noticed at the Upper Fillmore and Union Street, he needs to take a mental walk to his own district and see all the businesses that have been there since I was little girl going to high school to get out there.
Yeah.
A lot of that stuff he's closing. So that's telling me that should be trying to tell something that something is happening in the city.
All right. Well, I appreciate it. And I guess, first and foremost, ma'am, if you need help, obviously we're here to help and, you know, try to connect you to appropriate housing or transitional housing situations if you're not already. So happy to help out there.
I do stuff with the homeless coalition. We have had issues like with shelters and stuff.
Sure.
And, you know, I know that y'all do give money and stuff, but maybe they need to find appropriate people to handle the situation because some of the stuff that y'all sublease to the people is not working.
Okay.
And so it needs to be new.
I hear that. And I think, you know, additionally, just to be clear, I mean, you know, 4 years as budget chair, you know, homelessness and getting more investments for homeless services and homeless housing is a big priority for us. I mean, since Mark was budget chair from year one to year four, we've seen $81 million new dollars in terms of investments for homeless housing and services. It's not enough. We'll be the first ones to admit that, so we get exactly where you're coming from. You know, on the foster care system and things like that. Outside of City Hall, I serve on a nonprofit board of directors, City Youth Now, that tries to help children coming out of the juvenile justice and foster care system. So I'm definitely aware of that, you know, and we got some additional funding last year.
That's the sad part about it, is that they're coming out of foster care, and because of not having a place to go, they're getting in trouble.
Yeah.
And they're ending up in jail and in prison.
No,
and that's not good.
Like I said,
you know?
So, you know, from our perspective, you know, budgetary is around priorities and values. You know, we think we've been very clear with our priorities and values and really focusing on homelessness and needed investments there. Again, it's not enough, but we need to continue to work together to make sure we're getting more.
And so that's why they need to have people come to the table that's been there and done that and can, you know.